Good evening, Safe to Serve International, and welcome to another Thursday evening Bible study. As usual, we are thankful to God for this opportunity, and we have to be very grateful that we have another chance to spend time in God's presence, to receive His Word, that eternal life may begin right now, and we will then continue this eternal life when Christ Jesus returns. At this time, our son Christian will come and recite his memory verse, and then my wife Hillary will sing the song of meditation, after which we'll begin the study of God's Word this evening.
Daniel 8, verse 14. And he said unto me, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. Daniel 8, verse 14.
Save me, O God, for the waters are come unto my soul. I sink deep in mire, where there's no standing. I am come into deep waters, where the floods flow. For the zeal of thine house hath eaten me up, and the reproaches of them that reproach thee are fallen upon me. Save me, O God, for the waters are come unto my soul. I sink deep in mire, where there's no standing. I am come into deep waters, where the floods flow. Thou hast known my reproach and my shame, and my dishonor, mine adversaries before thee. I looked for some to take pity, but there was none. Save me, O God, for the waters are come unto my soul. I sink deep in mire, where there's no standing. I am come into deep waters, where the floods flow. But I am poor and sorrowful. Let thy salvation, O God, set me on high. I will praise the name of God with a song, and will magnify him with thanksgiving. Save me, O God, for the waters are come unto my soul. I sink deep in mire, where there's no standing. I am come into deep waters, where the floods blow. Save me, O God.
Daniel chapter 12, verse number 11, the Bible says, and from the time that the daily shall be taken away, and the abomination that maketh desolate set up, there shall be 1,290 days. Now follow me very carefully here. For the past few weeks, we have been covering this phrase, the daily sacrifice. Because not everyone who listens to Save to Serve and Prophesy Again are Seventh-day Adventists. Some are outside of this message. So we are to be careful how we break this message to them, leading them gradually. As they accept the spirit of prophecy, then you can pull out earlier writings, page 74, showing the words daily sacrifice. And the word sacrifice is a supplied word. It does not belong to the text put there by man's wisdom. So the daily sacrifice from this point forward, we shall call it just the daily. And the Bible tells us in history that the daily represents, firstly, the Roman Empire. And friends, many times I spent time in recapitulating what we have covered before, going over the same points. This evening, I'm going to move forward because we have some pivotal, potent points to cover this evening. So the daily points to the ancient Roman Empire. And we have discovered that the prevailing religion, hear me carefully, the prevailing lifestyle practices of the ancient Romans during the time when Rome ruled the world, it was paganism. It was what, friends? It was paganism. And we discovered from even the Roman Catholic news press that paganism in the time of the Roman Empire, it represents legalized. It represents legalized homosexuality. Notice carefully. Legalized homosexuality, which is nothing but legalized atheism. We covered this before. This is the daily Roman Empire, paganism. And this paganism points to legalized homosexuality and atheism. Look with me now at verse number 11. Daniel 12, and from the time that the daily shall be taken away, and the abomination that maketh desolate set up. We discovered that the abomination, notice carefully, that the abomination of desolation points to the papacy. Amen? This points to the papacy. And the Bible gives us a prophecy that the abomination of desolation, underscore this, would be set up. The word set up doesn't only mean when the papacy would rise, but set up means when the papacy would both rise and rule. And the time period for the taking away of the daily pagan Rome. This began in what year, as we discovered in our last session? It began in the year 508 AD. And we read a statement from Uriah Smith, and this statement is on your Bible study guide that will be posted after this study, okay? In 508, the daily began to be taken away. Rome was broken up into 10 divisions. France was one of those 10 nations, 10 kings. And France in the year 508 was the first nation to remove legalized homosexuality, atheism, paganism from the nation, and then to legalize the religion of Roman Catholicism in that nation of France. And that began in the year AD 508. And verse number 11 of Daniel 12 says, follow me carefully, that you must count now 1290 prophetic days, or 1290 years. So taking 508 and add 1290, we arrive at the year 1798. And what happened to the papacy in 1798? What happened to the abomination of desolation in 1798? The papacy received her deadly wound in 1798. Now, let us focus on verse number 12 of Daniel chapter 12. It says, blessed is he that waiteth and cometh to the 1335 prophetic days. Pause right there. So when does the 1335 prophetic days, 1335 years, 1335 years begin? It began at the same starting point of the 1290 prophecy, which is AD 508. Let's note that on the board. So the Bible tells us in verse number 12, that here we find another prophecy, 1335 years. And the starting point is AD 508, because verse number 11 and verse number 12 are connected. So starting at 508 AD, and we travel 1,335 years in the future, we add these years, we arrive at the year 1843 AD. Notice now what this says. Notice now carefully what this says in verse number 12. Blessed is he that waiteth and cometh to the 1,335 days, prophetic days, 35 years. Now pause right there for a minute. I want you to understand more carefully what verse 13 is saying. Verse 12 says, blessed is he when he comes to the end of the 1,335 years, which is 1843, God's professed people are to wait. Let's go again. Blessed is he that waiteth and cometh to 1843. So this is telling us, in other words, that when God's professed people came to the year in 1843, they were to wait. They were to have patience. They were to remain faithful. Do not forget that, save to serve. We should come back to this point. Go back again to verse number 12. Could you kindly do something for me? Take the word waiteth and put that word where cometh is, and take the word cometh and put it where waiteth is. And notice now the true understanding of verse 12. It says, blessed is he. When he comes, he must wait when he get to 1,335 years in the future, or 1843. So this tells us when God's professed people came to the year of 1843, that they had begun a waiting time period. 1843 began a tarrying time. Is that clear, my friends? 1843 began a what time? 1843 began, my friends, a tarrying time. Now, let's confirm that. What year it began? It began in the year 1843. What did God's people, the Millerite Adventists, what did God's people expected? What did they expect to take place in the year 1843? When 1843 came around, the Adventists, the Millerite Adventists, what did they expect to take place in 1843 AD? They expected the second coming of Jesus Christ. Don't you forget that. Because what we're showing is 1843 began a waiting time, began a tarrying time. Look with me. The last time we were together, I quoted a statement from Testimonies for the Church, volume 1, page 52. I'll quote that one more time. Volume 1, Testimonies for the Church, page 52. I'm quoting from paragraph 2. It says, calculation of the time was so simple and plain that even children could understand it. What does this mean? Let's pause right there for a minute. That means the prophecy that we're studying, even the children in the time period of 1843, they could understand it and they could also teach it. What is the application for us? Our children today should be able to comprehend and teach the prophecies of Daniel and the Revelation, even this prophecy, the 1290 and the 1335. I'll read on. From the date of the decree of the king of Persia, found in Ezra 7 and was given in 457 BC before Christ, the 2,300 years of Daniel chapter 8, verse 14, must terminate in 1843. Accordingly, we look to the end of this year, 1843, for the coming of the Lord. We were sadly disappointed when the year entirely passed away and the Savior had not come. So now, in 1843, they're expecting the second coming of Christ. Christ did not come. As a result, they entered a waiting time. Blessed is he when he comes to 1843, the ending of 1,335 years. He is to wait. Have patience. He must remain faithful. Is that clear so far? And what we're going to see as a tarrying time began in 1843. Based on the 1,335 year prophecy, or the 1335 days prophecy of Daniel 12 verse number 12. 1843 began a waiting time, a tarrying time, and that tarrying time extended to when? Who knows? The tarrying time came to an end when? Who knows? The tarrying time, which began in 1843, extended to what year? Who knows? It extended to October 22nd, 1844. We're going to confirm that. It extended to October 22nd, 1844. The tarrying time began in 1843 and extended to October 22nd, 1844. Listen what this says in Great Controversy. Great Controversy, write down page 391, paragraph 1. I'm going to quote now from Great Controversy, page 399, paragraph 4. It says, the 10th day of the 7th month, the great day of atonement, the time of the cleansing of the sanctuary, which in the year 1844 fell on the 22nd of October, was regarded as the time of the Lord's coming. What question? Did Christ appear on October 22nd, 1844? No. So God's professed people, they were also in a time of discouragement, a time of disappointment. This was a time of tarry, a time to wait. And think about this. Let's go back and quote now. Daniel 12 and verse 12. Blessed is he that waits when he comes to the ending of the 1335 years in 1843. And God's professed people who were expecting Christ to come in 1843, when Christ did not appear, that handful of believers still remain faithful and remained patient. Is that clear so far? Follow me now. They had expected Christ to come in the spring of 1844, the spring of 1844. When Christ did not appear, again, a certain group of people were found waiting, were found patient, were found faithful. Is that clear so far? And when they expected Christ to come, October 22nd, 1844, and they experienced that great and bitter disappointment, again, history tells us that significant, certain handful of people, they still remain faithful, patient in a waiting time. And because they were found patient, because they were found waiting, because they were found faithful, God now came through inspiration, through the Holy Spirit, and revealed to that small group of people, beginning with Hiram Edson, a few hours after October 22nd, October 23rd, 1844, God began to reveal why there was a great disappointment, October 22nd, 1844. In other words, the point I'm making here is that there was a blessing. They received a blessed revelation because in the tarrying time, they remained faithful. They remain prayerful. They remain in a waiting, patient condition. And because they waited faithfully, God blessed them with the knowledge of truth. Is that clear so far? Now, this is the truth of the 1335 days prophecy. But why are we studying this? We are studying this because there is a potent antitypical application of the 1335 days prophecy. So now, understand this before we make the application. The 1335 days prophecy, which began in 508 and came to an end in 1843. This prophecy covers a tarrying time. Is that clear? And the tarrying time began in the year 1843 and extended to October 22nd, 1844. There is an application of this. Follow me now, my friends. You have to see this. There is an application of this, and you must see it. Listen what this says. I want to put this on the board so nobody misses the point. 1335, amen, which began in what year? A.D., notice, A.D. 508, and came to an end when? It came to an end in the year 1843. And we just discovered, do you see why I'm going back over this? Don't miss it. And we just discovered, my friends, follow me now, we just discovered the tarrying time. I love writing, friends, so you can get this. The tarrying time began in the year 1843. It extended to the year 1844, October 22nd. Now, what event, follow me now, what event began October 22nd, 1844? Talk to me. What event began October 22nd, 1844? The answer to this is critical, it's crucial, it's important as we make the application. What event began October 22nd, 1844? This event is the opening, put this in your notes, the opening of the investigative, judgment. This is the event which began October 22nd, 1844. Is that clear, my friends? So here we have it. October 22nd, 1844. Which event began right here? Come on. Which event? This is the opening. Opening of what? The opening, in short, the opening of the judgment. Is that clear? And the tarrying time began what year? It began in 1843. There is a parallel of this, an antitypical application. So now, since we have over here the opening of the investigative judgment, here comes my question. Which event in the near future would be the antitypical application for the opening of the judgment? Which event? Okay, you got it. It is the closing. Let's study, my friends. The closing of the investigative judgment. Oh, my friends, you must see this. It is the closing of the investigative judgment. So now we need an event that will parallel 1843. And then we know for certainty that we have begun the tarrying time. Is that clear, my friends? So now, in 1843, what happened in 1843, based on what we have covered before, what was the Millerite Adventist expecting to take place in 1843? They were expecting the second coming of Jesus Christ. So this 1843 points to an event that must take place in these last days. That will be the antitypical application. So which event would parallel 1843 when they expected the second coming of Christ? Is there a recent event that we should point to as an event that must signal that the second coming of Christ is even at the doors? Which event is this? Okay, friends, I'm going to prove this. Which event is this? This event, my friends, is when the United States of America, legalized homosexuality, which is legalized atheism. Is that clear? So when America legalized same-sex union, America legalized homosexuality, this is the event, listen to me, this is the event that we must understand that shows us the second coming of Christ is even at the door, and now we have entered a tarrying time. Let's make sense of this, friends. Follow me very carefully. In 1843, they expected what? The second coming of Christ. Is that clear so far? And we just said this event here, The legalizing of homosexuality is the event that signals the second coming of Christ is near. Pastor Andrew Enriquez, confirm your point. Listen to me carefully, my friends. Hear me very carefully. Is the papacy about to rise? All right. And when the papacy re-emerges, will there be the enforcing of the national Sunday law? Amen. And when the national Sunday law is enforced, will that show us Christ is now about to come? Yes, this is chapter 14 of Revelation, verse 9 through verse 16. The last event before Christ is seen in the clouds, coming with the sharp sickle to reap the harvest. Verse 9 says, if any man worship the beast or his image and receive his mark, the same shall receive the wrath of God. The last event before the second coming of Christ is the enforcing of the mark of the beast, the re-emerging of the papacy. Is that clear so far? So how does the re-emerging, follow me, how does the re-emerging of the papacy connects with America legalizing homosexuality? What is the connection here, Pastor? Follow me carefully. Do you remember we covered pagan Rome? Out of which entity did the papacy rise? Starting in 508 even to 538. Out of which entity did the papacy rise and began ruling? Out of which entity? The Bible tells us in Daniel 7, verse 7 and verse 8, that the papacy, the little horn, rose out of the Roman Empire. You know what? Let's go to the board here. The papacy rose out of what entity? It says, watch carefully, that the papacy, friends, you must get this, the papacy rose out of which? It rose out of the Roman Empire. That's clear, right? Amen. Now, what was the prevailing religion of the Roman Empire? Talk to me. What was the prevailing national practice of the Roman Empire? Amen. It was what, friends? It was paganism. We are studying here, my friends. I love when we study. Follow me now. And what was paganism? How was paganism defined in the time period of the Roman Empire? You got it, my friends. It was legalized. You got it, my friend. It was legalized. Legalized what? It was legalized homosexuality, which is nothing but legalized atheism. Do you see it now, my friends? Follow me now. So in the condition of the ancient Roman Empire, paganism, follow me, when they legalized homosexuality, in that condition, the papacy rose. Do you see it now? Let's pause now. Which nation does the Bible say in Revelation 13, verse 11 through verse number 17? Which nation will heal the wound of the papacy? Which nation, my friends? It is, follow me, it is the United States of America. Is the nation to heal the wound of the papacy, America. So now, do you see now, my friends? The Roman Empire, pagan Rome, legalized homosexuality, the papacy rose. Do you see it now? America has now legalized homosexuality, which is legalized atheism. So who will now rise? The papacy will re-emerge on the scene. Pause right there. Remember, America was not the first nation to legalize homosexuality. So why are we focusing on America? Because the Bible tells us America is a central location of end time Bible prophecy. And this scripture, the 13th chapter of the Revelation, verse 11 and verse 12, confirm that it is the United States of America that will heal the wound of the papacy. And since America has now become the modern day daily, the modern day paganism, the modern day nation, as the Roman Empire was to legalize homosexuality, amen, which is legalized atheism. That tells us the papacy is about to rise. The papacy is about to re-emerge. Do you see now, my friends? And once the papacy re-emerges, she can only re-emerge when the mark of the beast is enforced. So what is the connection then between the rise of the papacy, the mark of the beast, the Sunday law crisis, with legalized same-sex union, legalized homosexuality in America? Now the papacy is about to re-emerge. Jesus Christ is soon to come. Do you see now, my friends? So let's go. So now, what day did America legalize homosexuality, same-sex union nationwide? What date? The date, my friends, is June 26, 2015. So since June 26, 2015, what time have we entered? You got it? What time have we entered? We have entered the tarrying time just before the closing of the investigative judgment. We are here, my friends. We are here. We are here. Let's take a look at this from another perspective. All right? The 1335 prophecy. Follow me. The 1335. This prophecy brings us to what year? 1843. Amen? And what other prophecy does the Bible say is connected with the 1335? The 1290, because both prophecies begin in the year 508 AD. They are connected. Do you see it now? And what is entailed in the 1290 prophecy? The taking away of the daily, the taking away of paganism to give rise to the papacy. So now in the last days, is paganism here, specifically in the United States of America? The answer is yes. Are the ministers now saying we must get control of lawmakers to now legalize morality? Yes. Is the papacy, is Pope Francis now saying that the thing to preserve family and to push back against legalized immorality, legalized same-sex union, is the enforcing of Sunday observance? Yes, we are here. This tells me, my friends, since America enforced same-sex union and has now become the antitypical daily, the antitypical Roman Empire, the antitypical nation to legalize the paganism, legalize immorality, the next step is the papacy is about to re-emerge. The mark of the beast is about to be enforced. At this point, my friends, June 26, 2015, we have entered the tarrying time. Pause. In 1843, they expected Christ to come. Now, since June 26, 2015, we should now be looking for the second coming of Christ. October 22nd, 1844 was the opening of the judgment. Now, we are looking now, we are nearing the closing of the investigative judgment. Is that clear, my friends? We have entered the tarrying time. Daniel 12, one more time. Daniel 12 and verse 12. So what now is God saying to us as we have come to this tarrying time? Friends, I'm serious. I was listening here and there to bits and pieces of these sermons that were being presented at the general conference session just a few days ago. Now, some of you can argue that some of those sermons were, you know, good to some extent. But my friends, the prophecies, I mean, the end time prophecies, the present truth was hardly presented and expounded upon. Friends, hear me carefully. We have now entered the tarrying time. Paganism was legalized June 26, 2015. And the Bible says the papacy is about to be is about to reemerge. We must now be looking for what great event? For what great event? Number one, the closing of the investigative judgment and the second coming of Christ. So what does God say to his people when they come to the tarrying time? He says, you'll only be blessed if you're found faithful. You'll only be blessed if you are found patient. You'll only be blessed if you are found in a state of waiting on the Lord. Daniel 12, verse 12, blessed is he that waiteth and cometh to the tarrying time. Are we here, my friends? Now, follow me carefully. What we're going to do now is make a parallel. Make a what? Make a parallel between the tarrying time of 1843 to October 22nd, 1844, the opening of the judgment. And the majority of the events that transpired in that tarrying time will transpire again in this tarrying time, which I am showing you from one perspective, began June 26, 2015, until the closing of the investigative judgment. Is that clear now? Firstly, what messages, hear me now, what messages were proclaimed? What messages were proclaimed between 1843 and the opening of the investigative judgment? Because those messages are now due to the church and the world before the closing of the investigative judgment, especially since June 26, 2015. Here we have here, my friends, paganism. Here we have here, my friends, the daily. So now, what messages were proclaimed? Inspiration says it was the first. It was the second angel's messages that were proclaimed in the tarrying time between 1843 and October 22nd, 1844. So what messages are now due to the church and the world since June 26th, 2015 until the closing of the investigative judgment? It is not only the first and the second, but the third angel's message. Listen what this says as I quote. I'm quoting now, my friends, from Selected Messages, Book 2, page 104, paragraph 3. It says, the first and the second messages were given in 1843 and 1844. And we are now under the proclamation of the third. But all three of the messages are still to be proclaimed. It is just as essential now as ever before that they shall be repeated to those who are seeking for the truth. By pen and voice, we are to sound the proclamation. Listen now, friends. The first message, the first angel's message says what? Let's quote it. Chapter 14 of the Revelation, verse 6 and verse 7 says what? Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. We'll come back there. And worship him that made heaven, earth, seas, and the fountains of waters. Pause right there. It says we must fear God. Give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. The judgment is come. Pause right there. So between 1843 and October 22nd, 1844, listen, fear God, give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. Looking backward, that judgment signified the opening of the judgment. Now come to application. What is due to both the church and the world? Since June 26, 2015, we must be proclaiming to everyone. It's time to fear God. It's time to give glory to Him. Why? The hour of His judgment is come. What judgment is present truth now? Oh, friends, not only the opening, but warning people, the closing of the investigative judgment is nearer than many of us believe. And remember, when the mark of the beast crisis is enforced, God's professed people, Seventh-day Adventists, are tested first. And based on our decision at that time, our cases will have a verdict pronounced on them. We will either be sealed for heaven or be seared for damnation. The hour of His judgment is come. Is that due to the world right now? And worship Him. It's time to stop playing games, my friends. It is due to the world ever since America has now become the antitypical daily, the antitypical paganism. It's time. The papacy is about to rise. The mark of the beast is about to be enforced. Fear God and give glory to Him. The hour of His judgment is come. What says the second angel's message that was proclaimed in the tarrying time between 1843, October 22nd, 1844, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. But now comes the repetition of the second angel's message, which is found in chapter 18 of Revelation, verse 2. It says, Babylon is fallen, and is become the habitation of devils, the hold of every foul spirit, the cage of every unclean and hateful bird. Friends, don't tell me. Since America has legalized paganism, homosexuality, we are seeing all around the world homosexuals even mocking Christ, mocking Jesus, mocking even the crucifixion, burning Bibles. It says Babylon is fallen. It's become the habitation of devils, my friends. And we're told in inspiration, in the first coming of Christ, when Christ walked this earth at the first advent, that devils, demons, had taken over the organs of individuals and began to use those organs to carry out the vilest lust. That is homosexuality and sodomy. Babylon is fallen, my friends. You can't see it. You can't see it, my friends. If I were to say, how close is Babylon to hit the ground, my friends? Less than an inch to hit the ground. That's how low Babylon is. And the Bible says, now come out of her, my people. This message is due to both the church and the world. And friends, mark my words very carefully. If there are ministers, even within the Seventh-day Adventist churches, who are drinking from the cup of Babylon, who have accepted the doctrines, I said, the false doctrines of Babylon and the false lifestyle practices of Babylon, God is saying, come out from those churches. Your souls are far more important than to sit in darkness. These messages are due to both the church and the world. But now inspiration says, not only the first and the second, but the third angel's message is due to the world. Since America has now become the antitypical modern-day Roman Empire, pagan Rome, the modern-day paganism, the modern-day daily, and the papacy is about to rise right now, friends. What is due to both the church and the world? It is the third angel's message. Oh, yes, my friends. If any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God. This is due to both the church and the world. Pause right there. Let's take one more step. Let me quiz you. So what messages were proclaimed between 1843 and October 22nd, 1844, the tarrying time? What was proclaimed there, my friends? Talk to me. What was proclaimed there? It says it was what? The first, follow me, the first angel's message. What else? All right. Number two, the second. And what must be given now? We have now, friends, the third. The third angel. The second angel. Now, what else was proclaimed between 1843 and October 22nd, 1844, the opening of the investigative judgment? Inspiration says it was the midnight cry. Number four. It was what, my friends? It was the cry at midnight. It was the midnight cry. I quote, great controversy. Great controversy. Page 398. It says, great controversy. Page 398, paragraph 3. It says, while the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. Where is that scripture found? That scripture is found in Matthew chapter 25. Let's turn there now, right? Come on, safe to serve. Matthew 25. Let's go there. Matthew chapter 25. What message was proclaimed in the tarrying time between 1843 and October 22nd, 1844, the opening of the investigative judgment also was the midnight cry. So what is now due to the world? Since America has now become the antitypical daily, legalized homosexuality, the papacy is about to rise, Christ is soon to come, what is due to both the church and the world? It is the message and its principles of the midnight cry. Great controversy 398. It says, and at midnight there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. Matthew 25, verse 5 through verse 7. In the summer of 1844, midway between the time when it had been first thought that the 2,300 days would end and the autumn of the same year, to which it was afterward found that they extended. Listen now, the message was proclaimed, listen, the message was proclaimed in the very words of Scripture, behold, the bridegroom cometh. So my friends, what message must now be given to the world? Listen to me, the midnight cry. I want to tell you something, friends. If our ministers had believed this, that as the Roman Empire legalized homosexuality, and out of the Roman Empire rose the papacy, and America is the nation to heal the wound of the papacy, and America has now legalized paganism, legalized homosexuality. Friends, this event should have awakened the church. And here we are arguing over this and that. My friends, the church should now be awakened. Well, some won't awaken the church because they themselves are asleep. But by God's grace, safe to serve, these Bible studies should awaken us to remain awake by God's grace and by His love and by His power to try to awaken others before the closing of the investigative judgment. Matthew 25, let's read this now. Matthew 25. So now, friends, what message must be given to the world? The three angels' messages also must be given to the church, even the midnight cry. I want to ask you a question. When the midnight cry was proclaimed, how many groups of people were developed and manifested? Two groups of people. What were they called? The five wise virgins and the five foolish virgins. So now, in the tarrying time, listen to me, in the tarrying time between 1843 and the opening of the investigative judgment, October 22nd, 1844, there were seen five wise virgins and five foolish virgins. So now, what two groups of people will be found in the church in these last days, beginning based on our study, beginning at June 26th, 2015, until the closing of the investigative judgment. Five wise and five foolish, two groups of individuals. It's time for us to get ready, my friends. Look with me. Matthew chapter 25, verse 1 through verse number 13. Speak about the five wise and the five foolish. Listen now, what great, take your book, Great Controversy. Great Controversy. I want you now to examine yourselves based on these words that I shall read. And think now, are you presently in the group of the wise virgins or in the group of the foolish virgins? It says, Great Controversy, page 393, it says, in this parable, Matthew 25, as in that of Matthew 24, two classes are represented. All had taken their lamps, the Bible, and by its light had gone forth to meet the bridegroom. Gone forth to meet whom? The bridegroom. Don't forget that. But while they that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them, the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. The latter class, the wise, had received the grace of God, the regenerating, enlightening power of the Holy Spirit, which renders his word a lamp to the feet and a light to the path. In the fear of God, they had studied the scriptures. In the fear of God, they had studied the scriptures to learn the truth, and had earnestly sought for purity of heart and life. Friends, are you a wise virgin? These had a personal experience, a faith in God and his word, which could not be overthrown by disappointment and delay. They were patient and faithful. Are you a wise virgin? Others, the five foolish, not saying five literal now. 10 is a number of universal. It's a universal number. 10 virgins, 10 commandments, 10 fingers, 10 toes. Amen. 5 and 5. It says, others took their lamps and took no oil with them. They had moved from impulse. Their fears had been excited by the solemn message, but they had depended upon the faith of their brethren, satisfied with the flickering light of good emotions, without a thorough understanding of the truth or a genuine work of grace in the heart. Are you a foolish virgin, my friend? And many times, hear me carefully, many times we say, oh, those church people who are in apostasy, those are the five foolish virgins. Don't mistake it. You are wrong. The five foolish virgins, it says, they had lamps. The five foolish virgins were around the five wise. They all took their lamps, the Bible, and were expecting. They went forth to meet the bridegroom. The majority of those in apostasy no longer do they believe in the imminent soon return of Christ. They don't believe Christ is even at the doors. Those folks are not even classed with the virgins. They are outside the circle of the five wise and the five foolish. And that's why it is so sad in this general conference session 2015 that just passed. One of the things they changed in their fundamental beliefs, they changed a specific word. That implies that they do not believe the second coming of Christ is even at the doors. The word that was there said imminent, I believe. Imminent. And they changed the word and put something else there. And many people are saying, this implies, yes, they believe it's coming, but it is not soon. Those folks are not even classed in with the five wise and the five foolish, Save to Serve International. Hear me very carefully. We are primary candidates to either be the five wise or the five foolish. Stop pointing fingers and stop saying those people. We need to examine ourselves. One more point to confirm this. The five foolish are not those who are in steeped apostasy, but those who profess the truth, those who are around, those who believe in present truth. It says in Christ's Object Lessons, page 411, paragraph 1, it says, the class represented by the foolish virgins are not hypocrites. They have a regard for the truth. They have advocated the truth. They are attracted to those who believe the truth. But they have not yielded themselves to the Holy Spirit's working. They have not fallen upon the rock, Christ Jesus, and permitted their old nature to be broken up. Do you see now, my friends? These are folks who profess and were once advocating present truth. Hear me, friends. This law in America, legalizing a same-sex union, the majority of professed Seventh-day Adventists became very, very excited. I want to say this. I believe these issues surrounding legalizing of homosexuality, it's going to die out just a little bit to cause God's professed people to go back to sleep, to go back into carnal security. And then they are going to sleep and sleep too late. And when the voice is now heard, the national Sunday law, the Sunday law is now enforced. Now they are going to wake up. But at that time, it is going to be too late. Is that clear, friends? This is the event. June 26, 2015, when America legalized paganism and has now become the antitypical daily, the church must now be awakened. And by God's grace, stay awake, or else you will be going to buy the oil when it is too late. Question for you. What did the five foolish virgins go to buy when it was too late? What, my friends? It was oil. So they went to buy oil when it was too late. What does the oil, who does the oil represent? The oil represent the anointing of the Holy Spirit. It represents God's people receiving both the early and the latter rain power from the Holy Ghost. It represents that God's Holy Spirit has now sealed them in His truth. The Ten Commandments, God's character is now sealed in their lives. Now, they went to buy oil when it was what? Too late. Go with me now to Revelation chapter 3. Where are we going to? They went to buy oil when it was what? Too late. They went to receive the character when it was what? It was too late. Question now, friends. So what event must awaken us? What event, my friends? Do you know that in Testimonies for the Church, volume 5, page 451, do you know we're told when the papacy re-emerges at the Sunday law crisis, we may know the end is now near? Okay, that's one step, right, in the future. And what event precedes the rising of the papacy? It is paganism. Amen. Come on, friends. And America is a modern day daily paganism. Are we now in the last days? So what must awaken us? We must now be awakened. What must we now seek for? The oil, the early and the latter rain experience. Revelation 3. Look with me, verse number 18. Now they went to buy. In Matthew 25, it was too late. So when must we now say, Lord, give me that oil? It is now. Especially since June 26, 2015. Verse 18. What are the three things that Christ says we must buy of him? Come on. Let's talk. What three things does Christ say we must buy of him based on verse 18? He says, buy of him gold, right? Tried in the fire. Buy of him the white raiment. Amen. And what is number three? Buy of him the oil to have our eyes anointed. Who does the anointing? The Holy Spirit of God. So now here comes the question. What does it mean to buy? B-U-Y. What does it mean to buy in the spiritual context? Well, do you think it means to bring money? No, because Isaiah chapter 55, verse 1, verse 2, verse 3 clearly says we can't buy with money. So what does it mean to buy? May I ask you a question, my friends? When you buy something, do you have a transaction? Does an exchange take place? When you buy something, you give and you receive, right? So Christ is saying it's time to buy. So there's something that we must give up in order to receive another. So what must we give up, friends? We must give up our sins. What must we give up based on verse number 17 of Revelation 3? It says we must give up our pride, give up our self-complacency. Bible says, because thou sayest you are rich and increased with goods, and are in need of nothing. This is what we must give up, my friends. Give up our sins, and then we shall receive. Inspiration says now, to buy means to make an effort. Let's pause. So what does it mean to buy? Come on. To make an exchange, all right? What must we give up? Our sins, our pride. Amen. What will Christ give us? The gold tried in the fire. The white raiment, and to anoint our eyes with eyesalve, the holy oil. Listen what this says now, friends. Are these things making sense? It says in Testimonies for the Church, volume 1, page 142, speaking about what it means to buy. We have to make an effort, it says. Heed the counsel of the true witness. Buy gold. What, friends? Buy gold. Exchange. Buy gold. Tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich. White raiment, that thou mayest be clothed. And eyesalve, that thou mayest see. Make some effort. What three words, my friends? Come on, everyone together. What are those three words? Make some effort. These precious treasures will not drop up on us without some exertion on our part. We must buy. Be zealous and repent of our lukewarm state. To buy means to repent. You make the spiritual transaction, the spiritual exchange. We must be awake to see our wrongs, to search out, to search for our sins, and to zealously repent of them. We must buy. When must we buy, my friends? Is probation soon to close? Are we in the tarrying time? Friends, I want to show you something. Go to James chapter 5 with me. You know what, friends? God just showed me something. This is not even in your sermon notes. God just dropped this point on me. The tarrying time to receive the oil. The character of God. The outpouring of the early and the latter rain. Friends, This tarrying time is a time when Christ himself is waiting. We think that we are the ones waiting on Christ. No, my friends, it is Christ who is tarrying for us. God is long-suffering to us, word, not willing that any one of us should perish, but that all of us should come to repentance, to make some effort. It is Christ who is waiting on us. What is he waiting on? James chapter 5. Just note this verse. Well, let's read it. James chapter 5, verse 7 says, "Be patient," that's to wait, tarry. "Be patient, therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman waits." What is he waiting for? "For the precious fruit of the earth, and hath long patience for it, until he receive the early and the latter rain." So friends, the prophecy of the 1335, it even reveals the character of Jesus Christ. Christ is long-suffering. Christ is waiting. Is this not a part of God's character? Moses, his words, "Lord, show me your glory," right? And Christ now began to proclaim his glory, his name to Moses. The Lord God, merciful, gracious. And what is number three? Long suffering. Is God waiting for us, my friends? And now we are told Christ is waiting with longing desire for the manifestation of himself in his church, when the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people, then he will come to claim them as his own. It is our privilege not just to look for, but to hasten his coming. And the sad reality is the majority of those who profess to be Seventh-day Adventists are only looking for, but not hastening, the second coming of Christ. How do we do this? It's twofold: to receive God's character and to proclaim both the message and the experience that bring to us God's character. Not only should we look for, but we must hasten the second coming of Christ, my friends. Question for you: how much longer are you going to allow Jesus to wait in this tarrying time? Think about it, my friend. Since June 26, 2015, when America legalized homosexuality, how much longer can Christ tarry? Can Christ wait? Can Christ look and stomach the sickness of his people, the sinfulness of fallen humanity? Friends, Jesus wants to come. Matthew chapter 25, go back there. Matthew 25. And those of us who get the oil now, question for you: when the five wise virgins had oil, when the bridegroom came, where did they go? Amen. It says they went into the marriage and the door was shut. So once we get this experience, the character of Christ, begging God for strength and endurance to make efforts continually, then, my friends, we can be found in that marriage, becoming one with Christ. And great controversy tells us what it means to go into the marriage. Question for you: what does it mean to go into the marriage? Because in the tarrying time, it says they went into the marriage. So now, since June 26, 2015, we must now be found in the marriage. The marriage takes place in heaven. Christ gone to receive his kingdom. So what does it mean to go into the marriage? Anyone knows? All right, take your book, Great Controversy, one sentence. And afterwards, you can read the paragraph. It says, Great Controversy. Page 427, paragraph 1, two lines. It says, but they are to understand Christ's work and to follow him by faith as he goes in before God. It is in this sense that they are said to go in to the marriage. All right, Matthew 25. Friends, we are coming now to a close. Now, if you're sleeping, wake up. Wake up, friends, because this point is crucial. Let's read Matthew 25, all right? I want you to read Matthew 25 and tell me now, what does verse 5 say happened to the virgins in the tarrying time, in the waiting time? What happened? Matthew 25 and verse 5. It says, all the virgins slumbered and what? Slept. It says, while the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and what? And slept. Now, friends, for years I struggled with that verse. You mean all virgins slumbered and slept? It says that. Now, friends, I'm going to give you two applications, two perspectives of this verse. All the virgins slumbered and slept. Number one, I don't believe the word all here means everyone. Because if you're sleeping, slumbering, literally and spiritually, then you will not be conscious, literally, spiritually, to be gathering and preserving oil for the crisis. I believe this word all simply means the majority. There are many texts that say all. It doesn't mean everyone. It means the majority. One example, the Bible says that Satan deceived the whole world. Now, will Satan deceive every single person, even the 144,000? No. All, whole, means the majority. One perspective. Now, hear me carefully, friends. But now, the second application is, it's a possibility. Even the faithful virgins were at one point asleep, slumbering. But something happened that woke them up before the midnight cry. All right. Amen. Something woke them up. As a result, my friends, they began to gather in the oil, preserving the oil to have enough for the crisis, now safe to serve. Watch this now. We need to examine ourselves. Lord, am I slumbering? Lord, am I sleeping? In this tarrying time, which officially, from this perspective of our Bible study, which began June 26, 2015, Lord, am I slumbering? Am I sleeping? Friends, and one thing I believe, listen, I'm going to quote you a statement. So now, you get this book called The Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 4. I'm going to quote now from page 242. Let's examine ourselves. Lord, am I slumbering? Lord, am I sleeping? Listen what this says. Because, friends, in this time of Earth's history, there should be no slumbering. No slumbering allowed. It says this, while the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. The widespread movement under the proclamation of the first message answered the going forth of the virgins, while the passing of the time of expectation, the disappointment, and the delay were represented by the tarrying of the bridegroom. After the definite time had passed, the true believers were still united in the belief, listen, that the end of all things was at hand. But it's, listen, But it soon became evident that they were now losing, to some extent, their zeal and devotion, and were falling into the state denoted in the parable by the slumbering of the virgins during the tarrying time. So what does it mean to slumber and to sleep? Inspiration says, friends, they began to lose, to some extent, their spiritual zeal for Christ, for God's truth, their spiritual zeal and devotion. So now, friends, have you begun to lose your first love? Have you begun to lose that spiritual fervor you once had a few months, a few weeks, a few years ago? It means that you are slumbering. You are sleeping, even though you profess to have Bibles, lamps. You are sleeping, friends. You are sleeping. So now, praise God. God now has sent this study to now awaken us. Since America, June 26, has now legalized homosexuality, paganism, the papacy is about to rise, the mark of the beast is about to be enforced. If you were slumbering, if you were sleeping, if you were losing your zeal for evangelism, your zeal for Bible study, your zeal for personal devotion, it's time to wake up. Beg God to restore unto you. Beg God to restore unto you the joy of salvation, the joy of his salvation. Beg God to restore unto you, my friends, the joy of salvation, and to uphold you with his free spirit. Are you slumbering? Are you sleeping? Isaiah chapter 56. Let's go there now. Listen to me, friends. Listen, I believe we're going now to Isaiah chapter 56. I believe that those foolish virgins, they were slumbering, they were sleeping, they were losing their zeal and devotion. But because they were around others who professed and were living and proclaiming present truth, they thought that they were in a saving relationship with Christ. What a deception. And I believe the five foolish virgins, they were relying on past experiences, thinking their past experience in the truth, in evangelism, in working for Christ, their past experience, the oil they had in previous times, would be sufficient for the present and the coming crisis. But they found out when it was too late, this cannot be the case. And we now today must learn from their experience. Friend, it's one thing to look back and see where God has brought us from. But my friends, every single day we must be eating God's word. Every single day we must be having daily devotion. Pray the prayer. Jesus, you promised to give me my daily bread, my daily experience, my daily oil. Amen, my friends. That means whenever the crisis comes, we are ready. Those five foolish virgins were not having personal daily devotion. In other words, they weren't having the true daily experience. They were having the counterfeit daily experience, which is paganism. Professing to be a Christian, but living like the world. Baptized paganism, the counterfeit daily. It's time to examine ourselves. Hear me carefully. Why do you think the majority of God's professed people now, friends, and listen, the five wise, five foolish virgins don't even comprise of those in apostasy? They aren't even numbered in this group. Question for you. Why do you think the majority of those in the world, in the church, and even the five foolish virgins are slumbering and sleeping? One great reason is because their minister, their pastor, their bishop, their elders themselves are slumbering and sleeping. And as they are slumbering, elders, pastors, as they are sleeping, the people who sit under these ministers also are slumbering and sleeping. Again, that's why I said earlier, it's time to come out from apostasy. Isaiah 56 verse 10, it says, his watchmen are blind. They are all ignorant. They are all dumb dogs. They cannot bark. What are they found doing? Here it is. They are sleeping, lying down, loving to slumber. Yea, they are greedy dogs, which can never have enough. And they are shepherds that cannot understand. They all look to their own way, every one for his gain from his quarter. Come ye, these shepherds, these sleeping pastors, say, I will fetch wine, and we shall fill ourselves with strong drink, and tomorrow shall be as this day and much more abundant. The ministers who are slumbering and sleeping, it says that they are drinking wine. They have gone to fetch wine, not the oil. And the wine here is to get them drunk. The wine represents doctrines. And since they're sleeping and slumbering, this is Babylon's wine. The doctrines and the practices from Babylon have now come into the churches, even among Seventh-day Adventism. Yes, my friends, that's the fact. And as a result, they are crying peace and safety. It says, last phrase of verse 12, and tomorrow shall be as this day and much more abundant. They are crying peace and safety. They will never emphasize with godly urgency. Probation is about to close. The mark of the beast is about to be enforced. Look at what America has just done. They are silent. They are slumbering, sleeping. Now, may I say, ask you a question. If you are lost, question, if we are lost, saved to serve, profess Seventh-day Adventists, if we are lost, can we blame our pastor? No. That means we ourselves must be awakened from our slumbering, from our sleeping. And the Bible tells us that while men slept, what does the enemy do? While men are slumbering, what does Satan do? Let's go. Matthew 13, it says in verse 24 and verse 25, while men slept, the enemy comes and sows what? He sows tares among the wheat. Let's go now. Oh, yes. Let's connect these dots now, my friend. It says, follow me. It says, while men slept, Satan sows tares. And the Bible says that one day the tares will be manifested. Now, the sleeping time, the slumbering time, is connected to what time period? The tarrying time. Are we in the tarrying time now? So friends, it's dangerous to be found losing your zeal for Christ, your zeal for personal devotion, your zeal for evangelism. It's dangerous to be found slumbering. It's dangerous to be found sleeping. Why? You will become a prime candidate to be a tear. Even though you profess to be around those who profess present truth, is that clear? Let's go. Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 24. Let's go there. Proverbs chapter 24. Okay, my friends, the title here is, the theme here is, that we are working with, this theme that we are analyzing is this. We are now in the tarrying time. No slumbering allowed. None, or else you will be lost. And God in his love, in his mercy, what is Christ now doing, friends? He's waiting with longing desire. Proverbs chapter 24. Let's now examine ourselves here. We are closing. It says, verse 13, I went by the field of the slothful and by the vineyard of the man void of understanding. And lo, it was all grown over with what? Save to serve? All grown over with thorns and nettles had covered the face thereof, and the stone wall thereof was broken down. Pause right there. So these people are sleeping. The vineyard represents God's professed people. It says that the vineyard is covered with thorns. While they are slothful, while they're slumbering, while they're sleeping, the first place in Scripture where we find thorns is in Genesis chapter 3. Thorns and thistles representing the result of sin. I'm going to come back to thorns. It says they're sleeping, they're slumbering. As a result, the stone wall is broken down. What does the wall represent, my friends? Oh, my friends. The wall represents the thing that would separate God's people from the heathens. This represents God's Ten Commandments, the wall. In one sense, that means these people, they are breaking the wall. Down the wall, breaking God's covenant, breaking God's commandments. They are slumbering and sleeping. And we must examine ourselves. And verse 32 is a startling verse, along with verse 33 and 34. Then I saw and considered it well, and looked upon it, and received instruction. Listen now, yet a little sleep, a little slumber. Yea, a little folding of the hands to sleep. So shall thy poverty come as one that traveleth, and thy want as an armed man. Friends, what have we covered earlier? Wherein people are traveling to receive something and do not receive it. As a result, they are poor, they are lacking, they are wanting. This represents the five foolish virgins slumbering, sleeping, go buy from him who is selling. They went to buy. It was too late. Here it is again, my friend. In Proverbs 24, a little sleep, slumbering, folding of the hands. When you fold your hands, you are no longer working for Christ. Slumbering, my friends. Sleeping. Many of us are selfish. Yes, we talk about the last days, but where is God's heavenly spirit of evangelism? Our hands are folded and we have gone to sleep, my friend. We are fast snoring. Yes, that's what it means. Yet we are told in Great Controversy, page 70, the first impulse of the truly converted soul is to lead a soul to Christ. But are you sleeping? Are you slumbering? Go back with me. The condition of the slothful, those who are sleeping. Verse 31 says, and lo, it was all grown over with thorns. And nettles had covered the face thereof. Thorns? Question, where else have you read about thorns? Pointing to people. Thorns. Yes, friends. The thorny ground hairs. Mark chapter 4, as we bring this to a close. Mark chapter 4, verse number 18. It says about the thorny ground here, verse, examine ourselves, friends. It says, and these are they which are sown among thorns, such as hear the word, and the cares of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches, and the lusts of other things entering in, choke the word, and it becometh unfruitful. Even though you are thorny ground hearer, God sends the word. What love is this, my friends? Oh, for God's love. Oh, for more of Christ's love to soften our hearts, to cause us to examine ourselves and lead us to realize it's time to not focus on the cares of this world at the expense of our salvation. Not to lust after riches and career while, my friends, our spiritual lives are dwindling, degenerating. Then it says the lust for other things, thorny ground hearers. Proverbs chapter 6. We close right here. Proverbs chapter 6. Oh, friends, we are in the tarrying time. Christ is waiting with longing desire for the manifestation of himself in his church. We must hasten his coming. We can hasten his coming if our hands are folded and we have gone to sleep. Whatsoever thy hands findeth to do, do it with thy might. Oh yes, because when you die, it's over. Listen, Proverbs chapter 6. Okay, friends, the next time you see the ants, the next time you see an ant, examine yourself. Listen what this says. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 4. The virgins slumbered and slept. Verse 4, give not sleep to thine eyes, nor slumber to thine eyelids. Verse 6, go to the ant, thou sluggard, consider her ways and be wise. Then it says, consider her ways and be wise. And then it says in verse number 8, the ant provideth her meat in the summer. And then what? And gathereth her food in what? Harvest. We close. It says, my friends, the ant does what? It says gathers. Notice, gathers what, friends? Gathers meat. In what time? Gathers meat in summer. And then what? It says, what, friends? And then it has meat for what time? For harvest. Startling, friends. Question for you. What does summertime represent in Scripture? The Bible tells us in Jeremiah chapter 8 and verse 20, that summertime, my friends, summertime represents the end. Jeremiah chapter 8, verse 20, it says, the harvest is past. The summer is ended. And we are not saved. Harvest is past. Summer is ended, and we are not saved. So summertime represents the end. Summer is ended. We are not saved. Summer, the end. The ant, it says, the ant prepares meat in the time of the end. Are we in that time, my friend? Are we in the tarrying time of the end? And because the ant provides, prepares meat for the end time, the summertime, then the ant can then gather in for the harvest. Which event is connected with the harvest? The event that is connected with the harvest, my friends, it is the second coming of Christ. Christ has the sickle. Thrust in thy sickle and reap. Why? The harvest of the earth is what? Ripe. So my question is, are you providing meat? Are you preparing meat? You can provide. You can serve unless you find and receive and have. Are we in summertime? Are we in the end? Yes, my friends, it's time to prepare. It's time to provide that meat so that when Christ comes, when probation closes, we can be in the harvest to go to heaven. Very interesting. The last thing Christ did before he went to Gethsemane and the cross, he was serving meat. My flesh is meat indeed. And that flesh, that blood represents his life. It's time to receive the righteousness of Christ. Oh, friends, do you want it? Oh, for Christ's life, do you want it? Father in heaven, we're thankful this evening for this study. Help us, dear God, not to allow the summer to end and we find ourselves in a lost condition. In this tiring time, no slumbering allowed, no sleeping allowed. Help us, Lord, not to fold our hands, but to receive meat from you, your righteousness, the message for these last days, the experience, and provide that meat to others. Save us, we pray. Lord, we thank you for tarrying. We thank you for waiting. We thank you for your longing desire to save us. We thank you. Help us now, Lord, not to keep you waiting any longer, but to hasten your coming. We can only do it by your strength daily. Give us the true daily sacrifice, the true daily worship, the true daily experience is our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.